Good afternoon. Welcome, everybody. I see folks are trickling in here, so I'm going to give us another minute or two until we kick it off here. But nice to see y'all today. All right. Well, we're 2 minutes past the hour, so we are going to jump in. Hi, everybody. We are here today to talk about the post-election dynamics and how we can manage change and build relationships from a Main Street perspective following elections. I'm very excited today to be joined by my colleague, Kelly Hummerkauser, who is the Director of Government Relations here at Main Street America. I am our Manager of Government Relations at Main Street America, and we are also very fortunate to have some Main Street leaders who are joining us who will speak on a panel about halfway through our webinar today. We have Jason Ford, Ellen Gamson, and Lisa Pellegrino-Spear, who we will offer some further introductions with some more detail later on in the hour. But with that, I'm going to share my slides and get us kicked off. So before we dive in, I think many of you all are very familiar with the Main Street America network at this point. I think we have a lot of folks that are probably calling in as Main Street directors. For those who aren't as familiar with our network, we lead a collaborative movement with partners and grassroots leaders that advances shared prosperity, creates resilient economies, and improves quality of life through place-based economic development and community preservation. We do this in downtowns and neighborhood commercial districts across the country. And we have a vision that everyone has access to an inclusive and resilient Main Street, a place that has a thriving local economy, is distinctive and rich in character, and features welcoming spaces and diverse businesses for residents and visitors alike. Our government relations team works across our network with partner organizations, also public officials, and other entities to advance our mission and vision. We speak and try to communicate the value of Main Street to decision makers. And we do this through a number of different avenues. We have an advocacy toolkit. I recommend that you all go to our mainstreet.org website and find our government relations page, where you can find more resources on our advocacy toolkit. We also lead an advocacy community of practice. This is a forum that we have for our network, any Main Street folks that are part of the Main Street American network, to come in a collaborative space to raise challenges and also share opportunities that you're facing and speak across the network to other Main Street leaders. We also have federal policy and funding resources, and we do a whole lot of coalition building, identifying the other organizations that do similar work to us or have similar missions and visions, so that we're putting our heads together and having a bigger impact. So today, we are talking about post-election dynamics, how to navigate this changing environment. Of course, there is just a federal election, so I think elections are on the top of mind for many people. We understand that there was an election, and also there's going to be a whole lot of local elections that didn't just occur that will come up, and we intend for this to be a resource that you all can use at any point when you're going through an election. So we're going to start with a little bit of what we're doing here today. We're going to give you some lessons and some tips and tricks on understanding key challenges and opportunities following an election and as you're identifying your new elected officials. And really a big focus today, and when we talk with our panelists, we're going to talk about relationship building and repositioning Main Street for success. As I mentioned, we have a great group of panelists that are joining us today. Jason Ford from Hartwell, Georgia, Ellen Gamson from Mount Vernon, Washington, and Lisa Pellegrino Spear from Clovis, New Mexico. So we'll speak with our Main Street folks for some time, and then we'll open it up to you all for a series of questions. Please feel free throughout the next hour to chat your questions into the question and answer feature. You should find that at the bottom of your screen, and my colleague Kelly will be monitoring that so that we can cover all the questions that are raised. With that, I'm going to pass it over to Kelly.
Thanks, Michael. We just wanted to start with a quick debrief. Both Michael and I are registered federal lobbyists, and as such, it would be inappropriate for us not to talk to you guys a little bit about what's happening in the federal realm at this time relative to policy development and the changes that happened with the election. Main Street America is a nonpartisan organization who's ever in charge of both Congress and the White House. We'll continue to advocate on behalf of Main Street programs at the federal level. And we're tracking all the federal programs that are important to Main Street and how they impact organizations across the country. This is what we regularly do and what we'll continue to do. And we just want you to know things are continuing to move in Washington, D.C., despite the fact that we had an election. Just this week, a new version of the weighted farm bill was introduced that has impacts on rural development programs. We know that next year is going to be going into 2025. There's going to be a lot of discussion about tax policy. But as we move through this space in the months ahead, we'll be particularly paying attention to who's in charge of different federal agencies that are important to Main Street. So we'll be tracking, you know, who's appointed to be the Secretary of Transportation, Housing and Urban Development, Interior. Those announcements are still coming and we're gonna kind of work through, and we might reach out to some Main Street programs if you've had interaction with those new officials. And we're also gonna continue to monitor kind of the legislative and regulatory activity in the new administration. I say change can be scary, and there are a lot of things that are coming up that are kind of, how is this going to impact our lives on Main Streets? And we encourage you to reach out to us about those things at any time in case you're wondering about how a certain policy might affect you. Our best, our job is to do our best to communicate the impact of those changes to you. We do know that in this next year, we'll also be trying to make sure that we're playing defense and showing how federal policies help Main Street. So if there's something that's really important to you, like the historic tax credit or CDBG funding, and you have a success story from one of those projects, you're also always welcome to tell us, because we know that it's going to be our jobs to make sure that those programs are continuing to operate and improving if possible. So with that, I'll pass it back to Michael to kind of start our conversation about, you know, actually, I'm going to hold on to it for another minute. Michael's going to advance the slide. Sorry, y'all. We're going to talk a little bit about why we're here today before we start talking about how we can be better advocates for Main Street. We wanted to give you a little sense of how you all should process these post-election shifts. So whether it's a change at the federal level that Michael and I are paying a lot of attention to, or changes that happened in your state legislature, your governor, or if you did have changes at the local level or anticipating changes at the local level in the future, this information can be evergreen, but anytime that there's a change, as a Main Street leader, you really need to pay attention to how those changes might shift what's happening in your organization. You need to think about who's been elected, and if a person retained their seat, does that also mean that they're going to increase their power, maybe change positions in committees? How might that affect you? What are the interests of those people that were just newly elected? Do they know about Main Street? Do their interests align with your work, or do you see some conflict there? And how can you do what you need to do to build new relationships or kind of think through what might be a challenge that's forthcoming because of this newly elected individual? So we have a couple of scenarios that we wanted to kind of share before we really jump into conversation. So you might see something happen in your world, like a new member of Congress at the federal level was elected. this person, this is just an example, but this person that was elected could be a budget hawk, meaning they are just, they want to cut the deficit, which is an admirable thought. They want to make sure that spending is low. And in that circumstance, they might be less inclined to support your ask for funding for a project in your community. They might not support earmarks. They might not want to offer you support for a grant program because they don't ideologically believe in that. That's a very possible thing that can happen. There's also regulatory changes that can happen with elected leaders who are in the administrative side of government, in your governor's offices, for example. So a governor could issue an executive order on any number of topics, but maybe a new governor comes into office and offers an executive order on complete streets. The governor of Pennsylvania offered an executive order just yesterday on making projects happen more fluidly, trying to reduce barriers. Those things can have good and bad impacts. So you might find that you're in a position of opportunity because some new policy happens that really supports you that comes out of that administrative side rather than the legislative side. And then finally, you might find that you just need to do more relationship building because you see some opportunities. Maybe a city councilor, you know that this guy supports small businesses. He's going to be supportive of small businesses in your community, but you got to talk to him and make sure that he understands who you are and what you do to support small businesses. So as you consider the different dynamics, maybe you do or do not know about the people that were just elected in your communities, but it's a good time to start thinking about those things and what dynamics might present themselves. So we just wanted to kind of ground set with some of those key challenges and opportunities. And now I will pass it over to Michael to talk a little bit more about the relationship building side of things.
Great. Thanks, Kelly. And yes, Kelly alluded to it. So there's been an election. So how do you build relationships? Also, importantly, how do you maintain relationships? And how do you position yourself in the Main Street organization following an election? I think a really key part of this is getting started before you even go out to engage other stakeholders. So understanding where you stand right now with your communication materials is going to be really important. You can go out and speak to elected officials and build relationships, but you definitely want to make sure that you have your elevator pitch down, that you know your mission and vision statements, so that when you're having these discussions and building these relationships, you can relate them back to your Main Street organization and its priorities. So some things you might want to start thinking about now before you start building those relationships is, have you reviewed your mission and vision statement? Are you familiar with it? Do you feel like you could talk about it without having maybe a document in front of you? Do you have an elevator pitch? Do you have that like 1 or 2 minute sell of this is what your Main Street organization does, and this is the impact that it has in your district, in your community? Importantly, is your website up to date? So do you have resources that are posted, including like key statistics on your organization and its impact that folks can go to, especially like staff and elected officials can go to without having to go through you, that they could go directly to the website to see your organization. You're also gonna wanna think about especially when you get to going to venues like the state capitol to do advocacy, do you have a one page or an annual report that can be used for advocacy? So when you do start to make those more official advocacy meetings, do you have the materials that you can bring and leave behind after those meetings? And then also just from a logistical standpoint, how are you going to track and manage these advocacy efforts? It's I think great for everyone in your organization to be thinking about building relationships with elected officials and with staff, but also having some internal management tools so you know who has been talking to whom and what relationships you're building and what topics have been covered is going to be really helpful so you can kind of consult back to what's already documented and build on the relationship that you've already developed. On the left, you'll see a little box here. This is kind of like a little blurb about how you can communicate the value of your main street. But really, the point that we want to drive home here is that you want to connect your main street organization to a broader impact that your elected official who serves a district is going to care about. So this comes from our Main Street America accreditation standards. This is something many of you all are going to be familiar with already. And it's really great framing to have in mind when you're talking to elected officials. So I'm going to read out this quote here. Main Street is positioned as an advocate for the district, promoting revitalization as an economic development priority among the public and private sector and community at large. So this both talks about what Main Street does, but also speaks to its impacts that an elected official is going to care about. So once you've done a little bit of that organization, thinking about your messaging, thinking about your materials, you're going to want to know who it is that you want to build a relationship with. Who are your elected officials? I think for many of you on the call, this is going to be information that you all know. I know for myself, it's always helpful to remind myself of the resources that are available and the sites that you can go to find out a little bit more about your elected officials. But you want to be thinking about it from a few different standpoints. From the first one, you want to be thinking about the different levels of government, who those elected officials are, when those elections take place too. So from a congressional standpoint, looking at who your members are, who your senators are, and who your members are in the House of Representatives. Also key here is understanding with your congressional legislators who sits on which committees and what committees they have jurisdiction over. You'll want to do the same practice for your state legislators, thinking about who are your state legislators and what committees they sit on. This gives you an idea of what their priorities are and what is really top of mind for them as they're going through legislative analyses. And also, importantly, your local legislators. Thinking about your city council members that you may have more familiarity with and may see on more of a day-to-day basis or work with on more of a day-to-day basis. And also, the folks, your elected officials at the county level. So, who are those county commissioners? Maybe it's not called a commissioner, but who is that county elected official? So we've listed a site here, usa.gov/elected-officials. This is one place you can go to understand who your elected identify who your elected officials are, and then understand a little bit of their background. This is one of many resources. So we encourage you to use this or use what you're already familiar with, or feel free to reach out to us to understand what's the best resource and website for you to use to understand who your elected officials are. But once you have identified who they are, you're also going to want to get a sense of what's their background? Specifically, what has their legislative history been? So, what's their professional background? But also, from a more personal standpoint, especially when it comes to those local legislators, what's their connection to your community? Is it a commissioner who owns property on your main street? Do you have a board member who might be connected to this legislator? That's all stuff that you can both figure out from your connections with your community, but then also go on to some of these websites to understand what they voted on in the past, what committees they've sat on, and what sorts of legislation they care about through their activity in whatever elected body they are in. If they're newly elected, it's great to go and look at their campaign priorities. Figure out what are the priorities they ran on and figure out what is the overlap with your Main Street organization and those priorities. It can be difficult when there's a newly elected official because they haven't set their priorities yet and they don't have a legislative history, so you don't know necessarily what they care about. But that campaign priorities, that at least gives you some level of some scaffolding for what they might start to care about as they get into the work. As I've already said, if they're returning, thinking about what bills they have sponsored, what bills they've co-sponsored in the past, and what committees they sit on. So on the right here is a little screenshot. This is from govtrack.us. And I'm looking at the congressional representatives in Virginia's 11th district. So what you can see here is a little border of the district itself on the bottom right of the screenshot. You see the senators that represent Virginia, and you also see the member of the House of Representatives, Jerry Connolly, that represents the 11th District. You can click on each one of those elected officials and find a whole lot of things about their voting history, what committees they've sat on, and it feeds a lot of these websites will take information from other sites and kind of assemble it all together and give you the most up-to-date, comprehensive kind of background on each of the elected officials. So this is all to say there's a lot of information out there. Choose the website and the tool that works best for you, and there's many. So feel free to reach out if you want help getting started. Once you're there, once you've kind of identified who your elected official is and what they care about, you're going to want to be thinking about how you're going to engage with them. And I'm really excited when a few minutes we're going to turn to our panelists to have discussion about how they've engaged with their elected officials. But this is just some food for thought, things that you can think about as you are thinking about engaging with your elected officials. It can be inviting them for coffee in your district. I think this is especially the case for your local representatives. If you have big ribbon cutting events, if there was a property that's been or a building that's been rehabilitated using a historic tax credit, and you know you have a state legislator who's a big proponent of the historic tax credit in your state, it would be a great opportunity to invite them out for that ribbon cutting event to show off your district, that project, and really give them the sense of how that policy, that tax credit, is playing out in your community. You'll also want to look for opportunities to make an office visit at the state capitol. This is kind of your opportunity to go to their turf, to speak to them and connect with them, with the understanding that your state legislators, you know, they have a lot on their agenda, and this can be the easiest way to engage them and their staff and talk a little bit about your background, what you do at Main Street, and what your Main Street organization does. And then also thinking about meeting with congressional staff. So you'll, especially when it comes to congressional legislators and state legislators, the point of contact often will be staff members, and that's great. So building the relationship extends beyond the elected official and goes to staff members as well. It can be a great way into that office, and also it's staff that really do a lot of the work and drive the policy and really know kind of the nitty-gritty about the legislation that the member cares about. So it's great to build those relationships with staff as well. You'll see here, this is a screenshot of a sample outreach letter. This is from a few years ago, but the general wording remains the same. It's an example of how you can reach out to your elected official, talking a little bit about how you make an impact in your community, attaching some resources, and following up, asking for a call or a coffee chat to continue engagement. So we have this posted on our website. We'll also be sharing these slides so you can consult all of these resources that we are referencing through this webinar, but this is a great starting point to put out an invitation on paper. So I think a few other tips and tricks as you're thinking about building these relationships. One is using your board, thinking about who your board members are, what their background is, what other boards they sit on, what organizations they've worked for, can help you identify what connections they might have. And it very well might be your board members that lead you to elected officials in your community and creating some connections and relationships with those council members. It's also important as you think about having a working board, assigning roles within your board to help ensure that you all are advancing your organization's goals and you all have the same kind of game plan about who is building relationships with whom. And finally, it's never a bad thing to be thinking about your partner relationship building with partner organization. So identifying those other organizations in your community that do similar work or whose mission aligns with you, identifying those collaborators, maybe tapping into their connections and their networks, understanding what relationships they might have with their elected officials can be mutually beneficial between the two of you. So make sure that you remember your mission and vision, you stay clear and committed to your goals, and always seek out that collaboration that just might lead you to another door and another connection to another elected official. And I believe I am turning it back over to Kelly to talk about some tools we've got.
I've posted a bunch of chats to the tools that Michael's been discussing in the chat. A bunch of links, I apologize. Oh, the first link that I chatted, and I'll chat it again, is to our Main Street America Advocacy Toolkit. In that toolkit, you'll find several one-pagers. We created these so that you could have an easy way to kind of start the process if you haven't done these things before. We have a one-pager on crafting a message for an elected official. If you're kind of like, yeah, what do I put in this email? Or I'm getting ready for the meeting and I don't know how to craft what I'm going to say to the elected official, there are some strategies for how to do that. And so we have a little bit of a formula on the crafting your message for an elected official doc that you could use for whether or not you're going to have a coffee with that person and what the key factors are that you might want to include, or if you're writing an email to that office to get the conversation going. We also have a one-pager on planning tours for elected officials. If you haven't ever hosted an elected official for an official tour of your district, I just encourage every Main Street out there to consider your role in making sure to make contact with both your state legislators, federal legislators, and I'm sure you always have your city officials in the district. But when you're planning for higher offices at the state and federal level for those tours, it could be good to go run through the details, have a game plan with your board, and make sure that you're kind of crossing all the T's and dotting the I's for that. So please check that resource out. And finally, building and maintaining relationships, a lot about what Michael is talking about now. To recap, maybe take this one pager to talk with your board members about how you guys are going to have a plan to build relationships through everybody in the organization with the elected officials that you're responding to. So you can take these handouts away and kind of use them as needed. And then one more note from me that I want to make sure to get in during our call, and we'll turn it back over to Michael for the panel next. But you know, Main Streets are advocating everywhere, and it happens all the time. And there's this huge thing that's happened over the past 20 years, and there's data to prove this, that people have just gotten less involved in advocacy. Across the country, not just in Main Street, but everywhere in the nonprofit space. Most of the time, people think if I saw a form online that says I sign on and it automatically sends a note to my legislator, like I've done my job, right? I hate to break it to you, but not quite. For Main Streets, we need to get out there and make sure that we're sustaining our programs. It's a key activity. And several of our coordinating programs actually activate and organize their leaders. And you'll hear a little bit more about that from some of our discussion participants. But I want to highlight, you know, great work has been happening throughout different state advocacy days at the Capitol. So on the left here, you see an image of Alabama Main Streeters at the Capitol. And on the right, you see an image of Main Streeters in Louisiana. When Main Streeters show up at the state Capitol and also talk to their legislators at home, takes both. We can make advances for programs, including more grant opportunities, more technical assistance, more training for all of our local programs. And so that's really important. If you're on this call and you don't have a resource to get engaged with state advocacy, Michael and I would love to hear from you because we could either connect you or make sure that you could be a point person for starting that effort in your state if it doesn't already exist. So that's my two cents, and I'll pass it back to Michael for a conversation.
I was on mute. Thanks, Kelly. So I'm going to open it up and invite our panelists to come on camera and on mic off mute. I have the pleasure of welcoming Jason Ford, Ellen Gamson, and Lisa Pellegrino Spear, who are all doing great work and have been doing great work in their Main Street communities. And we're going to have a little bit of a discussion on how they have navigated building relationships with their elected officials in their respective communities and across their states. So if I could, I'll turn it over to the three of you to introduce introduce yourself, your organization, and your role in your organization. And I will turn it over to Jason.
Yeah, sure. Hey, everybody. Thanks for the opportunity to come and talk with you today. My name is Jason Ford. I'm the Economic and Community Development Director for the City of Hartwell, but that role kind of encompasses our downtown development. So I would say in this space, I'm the Executive Director of our Downtown Development Authority and Main Street Program. I've been here for about 6 years, and you know, it's just been exciting to be a part of the Main Street movement in Hartwell over the last 5 or 6 years, because we've done a full-scale revitalization, and it's really benefited our community. So we appreciate being here.
Great. Thanks, Jason. And I'll pass it over to Ellen.
Hi, everybody. I'm Ellen Gamson. I'm with the Mount Vernon Downtown Association in Washington State, about an hour north of Seattle. I'm in my 12th year as an executive director, and I feel really fortunate to be around to see some of that incremental improvement happening at the local level. Thanks for being inviting me here today.
Great to have you, Ellen. And last but not least, I'll pass it over to Lisa.
Hi, all. I am Lisa Pellegrino Spear. I'm the executive director for Clovis Main Street, and I am just right behind Ellen. I'm at 11 years, and I've also served on our state program. We have a New Mexico coalition of Main Street communities, and I was the president for 4 years on that as well, too. I've been really blessed to have a lot of leadership and support with learning how to do advocacy. And so I feel like that's a passion and priority of mine, and it's helped launch our program into some great places. So I'm excited to be here today.
So that is music to my ears, that advocacy is a passion. It's great to have you. I'm going to stop sharing my screen. I am going to, it looks like y'all are already spotlighted, so we can see your faces here. And I do have a series of questions that I'm hoping can guide our conversation, but I do welcome you all to comment and react to anything you're hearing on our discussion today. But maybe I'll start off with one moment here. Jason, maybe could you start with sharing some key tactics that you've used to build strong relationships with new political leaders after an election?
Yeah, sure. You know, I think about this in some of the framework that y'all talked about earlier, kind of from a local, state, and federal level. You know, locally, we're a very small town. You know, we're the bump into each other at the grocery store type of environment. So if you don't know that person, there's one degree of separation. And so hopefully early and often we start building that relationship where it's almost like, hey, come by the office if you're running, and let me show you everything we've been doing and that we've been planning. And I can learn more about those priorities of a potentially elected official. That way, kind of, you know, if someone wins, you know, there's no surprises. Nobody likes to have a surprise. I certainly, you know, want to make sure that we're including feedback from, you know, these potential elected officials, because they're leaders in the community anyway. And so at the state level, you know, I hope to use our local elected officials to make that connection. But we're on one hand, we've got 159 counties in Georgia. So even our state officials aren't that far away. So similarly, we have a little bit of a relationship with our state officials anyway. But hopefully our local elected, you know, county commissioners, city councilmen have a great relationship with those state representatives. And it gives us an opportunity to, you know, build that relationship, talk about priorities. You know, everyone's doing great work in Main Street, so they're happy to show off, you know, something, you know, that's kind of positive to talk about. And then you talked about it earlier, staff. So at that federal level, the key to that federally elected is their staff and building relationships there.
Yeah. Thank you for that, Jason. I really love, especially at the local level, early, often, and even at the grocery store.
Yeah, I think Jason's right. I would just like to add on to what he said. I feel like when you create that, especially in a small town like I am as well too, as Jason, we're under 50,000 population. So there's always that one degree of separation. So finding that board member or yourself, doing the research on your legislators, finding out what their interests are, what committees they serve on will also help you identify what passions they have. If they're on something that's, you know, an economic based committee, or if they're on something that's maybe a tourism based or gas and oil or something like that, finding those ways to connect that into your district. And also just remembering that they're regular people. So you will run into them at the grocery store. You might run into them walking down your street. So, you know, it's important. They could be your neighbor. One of my legislators lives five houses down from me. And so I know that, you know, I need to build that relationship with them. And I know that there's some certain ways to tie into that. And then I think also, like you said, it's really important to build that relationship with their staff members as well. So on a federal level, you're going to have staff members in your community or in your region that you're going to be able to create those relationships with. And they're just regular people too. And they also are looking for things to report back. So making sure that you tie in that you know, connection of what you're doing in your community is helpful for them when they're going to report to their legislator, your federal legislators. And then your state legislators, it's really important to get in connection with their staff members. So when you go to the roundhouse, or I'm sorry, your Capitol, ours is a roundhouse. When you go to the Capitol, a lot of times you're not going to get those meetings with your legislators because they're on this floor, they're, you know, working with other legislators, they're in committee meetings. But getting to know their staff members, because those staff members are your key to getting time with your legislators. And that to me has been one of the most beneficial things that we've been able to do too, is getting to know their staff members.
I just have one thing, a couple of things I want to add. Early on in my tenure, I signed up as a neighborhood champion for our community with the Small Business Saturday movement. And I find that that is an excellent opportunity shortly after an election to reconnect or make new connections with officials at all levels. We've been fortunate to invite both local, county, and federal officials to come and enjoy Small Business Saturday in our downtown. They really enjoy the photo opportunity. They also enjoy connecting with each other if they're at multiple levels. And it's just a great feel-good experience. And oftentimes they're eager, it's before they get into session, and they're eager for an opportunity to be out in the district and seeing the folks that just put them back in office or elected them for the first time. And the other tip or trick that our state advocacy program sort of inculcated in me early on that I always try to remember is to always lead with a thank you when I'm meeting with an official at any level. Even if they're brand new, just thank them for running. Public service is hard. We know because we work in the public arena that it's often, more criticism than gratitude to do any kind of public service. And so it's always great to lead with a thank you. And certainly, you know, once you've established a relationship with them and you've known them for some time, you always have something real specific to thank them for. I think that's all I have to add to what's been said.
Yeah. Hey, real quick, I just want to tap into something that I think we all talked about, but when you're making those relationships with the staff, a tour, you mentioned it earlier, is a great way. We drive people around. We got this big, beautiful lake here in Hartwell. And so there's a couple of key, you know, spots that's real pretty to go see, or going to the dam that's out there. And there's some observation decks. So anytime we were able to get a hold of the staff and make make time for them to come to our community, we always drive them around to that point, but it gives us an opportunity to talk about things not work related also. So you build a little bit of a human connection beyond just the work environment.
And I'll say what I've seen in our district is sometimes those staff members, they're serving in that capacity because they have political interests of their own. We have a longtime staff member of a state rep who's been in service nearly as long as I've been the executive director, and she's now a city council person in a neighboring community that is the most recent new Main Street in our network here in Washington State. And so you just never know when those relationships are going to expand into even greater opportunities.
Yeah. And I think like what Ellen said, you know, inviting them into your district, and that's a huge, huge piece. So we like to invite them to come to our big events. And so invite them to your ribbon cuttings. We've offered them to be our judges for our Christmas parade, because that's the largest event that we have in our community every year. And which is really exciting, because then they get to see everybody at their best, right? And everybody when they're super excited and they're all celebrating with you. And that's a big piece. I think that's one of my favorite things to do. And taking them on tours of your district, like they can't tell that you need new lighting unless you're taking them down there and walking them through the district in the evening timeframe. So bring them down there, show them what you need, show them why you're asking for, you know, these different requests. And I think one thing, and I don't know if Michael's going to ask us this question or not yet, but one of the key pieces to working with your legislators is also starting at your local government. So if you get on point with your local government about talking about the projects that you need investment and that you need assistance with, then that goes a long way when you're talking with your legislators. So work with your local city commissioners, your local city managers, county managers, whoever it may be, to get on their ICIP list, you know, their infrastructure capital improvement plans. That way, then when you go and you talk to your legislators, you're telling them, hey, we need this, we need this. These are projects that our city has also identified as priority projects for our district. And that makes a big difference when you're talking with your legislators as well, too. I'm sorry, I have a window here that's like, I can't cover. So
I'm jealous of the natural light, Lisa. Yeah, and I think you bring up a good point there, kind of starting at the local level. And what I'm hearing from the three of you is there's a whole lot of different avenues to engage. You can do it at the local level, you can do it at the state level, you can do it at the federal level. It's good to engage your staff. It's good to invite them to ribbon cutting events. It's good to bring them on tours. So my question here is, how do you manage it all? How do you share that responsibility for promoting your Main Street to elected officials between your staff and your board members? Do any of you have insights on that?
Well, I would say in Hartwell, you know, we're a very small town. We only have 4,500 folks. And we have a large volunteer pool. So not just our board, but we have 50 volunteers strong who are ready to sit in, not just sit in city council meetings, county commissioner meetings, but they're ready to meet and greet and talk about our program as well. So we have a consistent message. You know, we have one page fact sheets and those types of things. So, you know, it's the power of many hands, I think, is important. And, you know, one thing I try not to do is let our board go and deliver any kind of bad news unless it's me and the chairman. And so that way the board is kind of always, to the extent that we can, be seen in a positive light that we're doing redevelopment. Yeah, we might be struggling through a project because it's time consuming and more expensive than we thought. All of those things are going to happen. But we try to create the environment where our board can celebrate the milestones along the way on the process, rather than say, hey, we're delayed because of X, Y, and Z. And so really it's setting our board up for success also with that message.
I think you're right on point with that too. I would say as long as you've got a board that, you know, utilize everybody on your board, that's one of the most important pieces. All of your board members know different people. So find out where those relationships are and who knows what legislator and what person and how they know them. And as long as it's a positive relationship, but also, you know, find out what your legislator's interests were. That's another key point.
If you are fortunate to have board members that are otherwise engaged with the legislators, and maybe doing their own advocacy work at the state level or at any level, it can be really helpful to be aware of when maybe they're going down. I have a board member who's involved with our local realtors organization. She spends a lot of time in Olympia, which is our state capital. She's also served as a regent at our local community college. And so she spends time in our capital doing advocacy for those organizations. And it's always great to make sure that they are aware of the ways in which those interests intersect with Main Street, right? So if you're a realtor, you want a vibrant community to attract new sales or new purchasers into your real estate market. There's obviously a good dovetail there, and just always keeping in the forefront of those opportunities to get even some, I don't know, I call it sideways advocacy happening when they're down there for other purposes. They can also be putting in a plug for your program.
Right. I love that, Ellen, and being as efficient as you can with the limited time you have. So I know we are this hour's flying by, so I want to make the most of the time that we have. I'm wondering, what strategies have you all implemented to secure funding and resources when there's different political administrations? Can any of you speak to experience there?
I'll speak. We're really fortunate in our state to have some state supported funding mechanisms available for our Main Street program, and I know that's unusual. But we annually, many communities or state coordinating programs will have a capital day at the state level. And we in January spend several days in our capital. And the first day is always training provided by the Washington coordinating program. And on our last day, we are encouraged to meet with our reps. And one of the things that we're really fortunate and really aware of in Washington State is that Main Street just has bipartisan support. I mean, who doesn't want small businesses, entrepreneurs, and rural communities to succeed? Nobody's going to say that they're not in favor of that. And so it's a universal positive message that can appeal to across all party lines. And so we've been super fortunate to have the support from our coordinating program to get prepped before we have those meetings. And to usually know if there is an ask that's relevant to our work directly or historic preservation in the first place. Our state legislature has a Heritage Caucus, which is a group of legislators that have been meeting for, I believe, decades, if not forever, every Wednesday morning at the ungodly hour of 7 a.m. And we always are on their agenda during that week that we're down in Olympia. And those folks care about preservation. They care about Main Street. They love to hear about how the state's investment in our program is paying off with the multiplier effect. And, you know, we are all given confidence and by being prepped so well through our coordinating program. But also a few of my local colleagues, we've also gotten in the habit of tag teaming our meetings with our area representatives. The staff sure appreciates it. It also, you know, there's power and authority in numbers. There's political will represented by showing up with a couple of your colleagues by your side. And so I would just encourage everybody to have that kind of advocacy day at your state level.
I agree with Ellen on that. I think that's one of the most important pieces is having that like within New Mexico, we have the coalition of Main Street communities, and that coalition helps train all of our economic our EDs to be able to know who their legislators are, where to look to find who your legislators are. And then that also, one of the things that we do is we try to work with our state coordinating program within the coalition, and we try to create a cohesive message to what we're saying to our legislators. So if our state program is asking for certain bills or, you know, certain funding amount, whether it's their local budget or capital outlay that they're looking for to bring into our communities, we're going to go in as the coalition and we're going to have that same cohesive message. So we all meet and we decide together, is this how much we're going to be asking for? Is this the bill that needs the most priority? What are those things that are most important to our communities in a whole across the state? And those are the messages we want to continue to spread as a group. And then on top of that, having your personal stories from your own district to put some personality and some experience into your storytelling. So storytelling is number one, remembering that your legislators, their assistants, everybody are regular people and they all live in your communities. So finding out those story, you know, finding those stories that you can share with them personalizes your request and your approach with them. And like Ellen said, you know, there's power in numbers. So what we try to do is we always try to do a buddy system. So if my community, being especially that New Mexico has a lot of rural communities, when we meet and we go to the Capitol, try to take your neighboring community as well too, because you will have some overlapping legislators. And what is important to this community, the neighboring community is going to be either benefiting from as well too, or could be a resource that could be helpful to their community. So taking your neighboring ED with you is super helpful. And it just spreads that power in numbers, and it shows that there's uniformity between your organizations. And it's really been a key piece for us. Another thing that I do, I know someone had put in the chat, like some type of leaflet or paper that you take. So we create a RAC card that I take, and these are all my legislative priorities. These are the funding requests that I'm going to be asking for. So you could see we had a train park or lighting and then wayfinding system. And then on the back, I put all of our key statistical numbers. So what kind of, how many new businesses we've had, how many net jobs, how many buildings sold, what type of private investment and public investment has happened over the past year or 2 years, however many years you need to do. But that's helpful because I leave this with all of my legislators. I leave it with all of their assistants. And so every time I go, I leave one with them. So they know, oh, Lisa's been back. And it's just a quick review. They don't have time to read a whole entire report. They don't have time to read, you know, a 5-page request, but they have time to read a leaflet RAC card. So know your legislators' timelines, know what their schedules are, because you're going to know that they're running around crazy around the Capitol for a month or 60 days, however long your session is. And it's exhausting. So know how to minimize your time and your request to be able to spread your message most effectively.
Yeah. And Lisa, when they have a RAC card that's pretty like that, they're going to want to pick it up.
Yeah, thank you.
I know we're coming up fairly quick on time here, so I will welcome anyone who is calling in today to, if you have a question, you can put it in the question and answer section at the bottom of your screen. I'm going to start, I think I saw one question in the in that feature here, and I think this may be in response to something that you were talking about, Jason. The question is, what suggestions do you have for building a robust volunteer pool?
Excuse me. Yeah. So two things, and one of them is a little bit tongue-in-cheek, but bring wine. That's sometimes helpful to get some folks together. But we have had a lot of success with making volunteering for our Main Street program a social activity. So we have Bring a Friend Day. Our volunteers meet the first Monday of every month prior to our city council meeting. So if there's something on the agenda, we can go in force from one meeting to the other. But what has happened here over the last 4, 5, 6 years is we've grown in numbers from 10 or 15 core volunteers to about 50 strong, and maybe even more. And it really has been that kind of welcome committee. Anybody who's newly moved in and looking for opportunities to get involved, folks say, well, come with me to this meeting on Monday and let's talk about Main Street. Because like I think Ellen said, you know, who doesn't want to, you know, help, you know, build your downtown into a pleasant place to to live, work, and play, and all of the things that we say. So I think I would start with really building and tapping into your social networks and trying to have a little bit of fun while you do that hard work.
That's a great rate of growth, Jason. And Ellen and Lisa, do either of you have anything to add on that, on the volunteer pool?
In our state, a few of us, maybe all of us, but many of us do an event annually that's just strictly about volunteer appreciation. And that goes a long way, you know, towards retention as well as attraction. Having an occasion where you can show appreciation and allow and encourage socializing is just invaluable. Some of us keep it more casual and some of us make it like a big gala kind of an event, but whatever fits the culture of your community, it's always a really good idea to set aside time to show appreciation.
Great. I would say go ahead, Ellen.
No, I was just going to say that in Washington State, a few years ago, we started doing an in-state Washington State Main Street Week in Mount Vernon. We've used that opportunity to combine drawing attention to the Main Street program and also thanking our volunteers and also inviting legislators to attend. So it's a win-win-win.
I think with volunteerism, if you're pairing volunteerism with advocacy, it's really important that you have your board members really be your key volunteers with advocacy, because you want to make sure that the right message is being spread. So having just your regular, you know, event volunteers and stuff, having them share their stories when they meet people, and knowing maybe your quick, you know, 5 second, you know, or 10 second elevator pitch, that's impressive and that's, you know, helpful when you're out and about on the street. But when it comes to advocacy, I'd keep it with your core board members, because they know all the work that you're actually doing behind the scenes. That's where I would stand on that perspective.
Yeah, great point there. And, you know, we're coming up quick here on time, so I'm going to do one final question. It's going to be a little bit of a speed round, but I'm hoping I can get your take from each of the three of you. What advice would you give to a Main Street manager navigating their first election cycle? So what should they prioritize in the months immediately following an election?
Yeah, real quick, I say this a lot in our community, but it's going to be okay, is what I would say. Like, you know, sometimes we get nervous about our priorities changing, our funding is going to, you know, switch. But keep doing the good work you're doing, rely on that, and it's going to be okay.
I'd agree. You know, quality of life is what Main Street delivers. And no matter who's in charge, everybody wants that. I think that approach is ideal. I also just think that the opportunity to just meet and greet, take it as early as you can, whether you take advantage of something like Small Business Saturday, or we partner a lot with our local chamber coalition to do a legislative send-off at the beginning of our state session. And then at the end of our session, we'll often have a wrap-up meeting that's available to the public. We work with both our chamber and the city to be aware of what their particular interests, whether it's Association of Washington Cities or the Chamber Alliance, what their legislative priorities are, and again, see where we all dovetail. So maximize your impact by partnering with others with the same interests that you have.
And I would say, Ellen, 100% on that. And then I think the other key thing to tell a new ED is, don't get hung up on party lines. Your program is not a party specific program, right? Like your work that you're doing, your small businesses, it doesn't make a difference. Same work, and we're all trying to create the same impacts. Don't get hung up on your personal priorities and your personal opinions when you're meeting with your legislators, if their views don't meet the same views as yours. I make sure that my legislators have no idea what side of the party I'm on. I think that's probably the most important piece, because I think that what work we're doing is work for everyone, and it's supposed to impact everybody in your community, this, you know, as much as possible. So don't get hung up on party lines.
Thank you. Thank you to all three of you. I think each of those, it was a perfect parting words for the end of this discussion. I really want to say thank you for joining us. I think you all have such rich experience, and it was so fantastic to hear how you all have navigated building these relationships and doing the great work that you do in your community. So thank you for joining us and for sharing those remarks. I know we're at the top of the hour here. I will let everybody know on the webinar, we are recording this, so we will share out that in our follow-up email. And while I have everybody for one last minute, I'm going to reshare my screen as a reminder that many of you have already seen, but Main Street America will be hosting our next Hill Day in DC. That's February 4th and 5th. We are expanding this year registration to all Main Street leaders within the network. So if you are interested, feel free to reach out. If you have questions about this webinar, want to get connected to folks that you heard talking today, or just want to continue the dialogue, you can reach out to our email, advocacy@mainstreet.org. So Lisa, Ellen, Jason, thank you for joining us today. And thank you to all of our attendees on today. Okay, bye everyone.
Bye-bye.